During World War II, the War Department enlisted Hollywood's top directors to offer their great talents. And they did it to record the history of the war and at the same time explain to the home front why this war was necessary. Among this team was the amazing, talented George Stevens Sr. Up until the war, George Stevens entertained us, beginning with the early Laurel and Hardy movies and the wonderful romantic comedies that included the first pairing of Katharine Hepburn and Spencer Tracy. And when the war began, however, he wanted to enlist, but thank God he was too old. That turned out to be a lucky thing because his great talent was used for something much more important. He still found himself in the most dangerous battles of the war, but now he was doing what he knew best. General Eisenhower asked George Stevens to be part of the invasion of Normandy on D-Day. He went on to record the liberation of Paris, as well as the Battle of the Bulge. He was on the front lines when the US Army went into Germany. And like all the other GIs, his life was changed forever when he walked through the gates of the concentration camp at Dachau. And so many ordinary soldiers said of that experience, after all the bloody fighting, the sacrifices and loss when they stepped into these camps, they finally understood why this war was necessary. When George Stevens came home, his war experience changed him. How could it not? His films were different. He looked at America through a highly refined lens, with A Place in the Sun, The Great Western Chain, and Giant, a film Joe Cal and I have watched again and again. It took him over 14 years to revisit the war, but when he did, it was through his most powerful work, The Diary of Anne Frank, in 1958. Please look at this clip from a documentary by this equally talented son, George Stevens Jr.
In 1958, he finally made his war film. The true story of a Jewish family hiding from the Nazis came from the diary of a 14-year-old girl, Anne Frank. He was moved that her ideas and her optimistic spirit survived in history beyond the powerful forces that persecuted her. He said he wanted the diary of Anne Frank to be evidence of a truth and close to the way it happened. In Amsterdam, he was shown the attic where the Franks hid for 2 years by Otto Frank, the lone survivor of the family.
I knew those were painful boards he was treading on. I couldn't help but think about it as he went up one narrow flight after another. And we took the last flight up toward the garret.
There was this window that was open. It was a gabled window. And when we walked up the ladder, there was some large bird. We didn't see it, but it made a great rustling. And this man was a strong man, but he weakened on that ladder. You know, the sense of life being there and being winged. And he was terribly shaken by that, as if it had been her spirit, or particularly her spirit, because she used to use this.
On his way back to America, he returned to the site of the concentration camp at Dachau.
Halt! Stehen bleiben! Halt! Stehen bleiben! Halt!
Save me! Save me! No, no! 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 Don't take me!
Stop it! Stop it!
We stuck with the feelings that were needed in the scene that day. He gave us everything. He gave us the sounds. He gave us the sirens. He gave us the sound of the Nazis marching in the streets. I mean, I could cry now. I mean, because of how much atmosphere he gave us. The atmosphere was a heavy atmosphere for 6 months for us to live with. We demanded the finest from you. And some people would dislike him because they felt so threatened by this demand because he never got close to you. I'd laugh to myself all the time because I'd see him looking through his sunglasses. You never got to see his eyes very often. He never looked directly at you. He never wanted to make direct contact too much unless he wanted to say, now this is the way this has to be done. Because all he wanted to do was do the work. We treat everybody differently, and it seemed to me he treated them the way he felt he needed to in order to get the performance out of them. And if he had to be cruel, he was cruel. And if he had to love, he would love. If he had to be standoffish, he was standoffish. Everybody's acting was a reaction to how he treated them.
I think the world may be going through a phase, the way I was with Mother. It'll pass. Maybe not for hundreds of years, but someday. I still believe, in spite of everything, that people are really good at heart.
I want to see something now, not 1,000 years from now.
But, Pater, if you'd only look at it as part of the great pattern, that we're just a little minute in life. Listen to us, going at each other like a couple of stupid grown-ups. Look at the sky. Isn't it lovely? Someday, when we get outside again, I'm going to...
Point out that the haunting photo of George Stevens on his return trip to Dachau after the war was captured by George Stevens Jr. Standing there, lost in his own thoughts, we see the anguish of memory in his face. All of you will be given this documentary tonight. I urge you to watch it. George Stevens Jr., like his father, has an impressive record himself. He was associate producer of the Anne Frank film and is the founder of the American Film Institute and the creator of the Kennedy Center Honors. He has also won an Oscar and 17 Emmy Awards. It is now my great honor, my great pleasure, to present George Stevens Jr. the Teddy Kollek Award on behalf of his father, George Stevens Sr.
My. Well, thank you, Ronald, for that lovely introduction, and thank you, Joe Carroll, and it's great to be with Secretary Powell. You know, and thanks to all of you who support the World Jewish Congress for this signal honor to my father. It would have meant, had profound meaning to him, I know. You know, and watching this film in that setting brought back memories of that extraordinary man who, I am pleased to tell you, was a wise, gentle, and loving father among his other accomplishments. He and I went to Europe in 1967 to prepare The Diary of Anne Frank. We drove to Dachau, where, as Ron suggested, I took that photograph of him in front of that concrete door. That door was labeled Brausbad, meaning shower bath. We walked the Normandy beaches together, his first time there since D-Day. Then we went to Amsterdam to a small building in the office district, in the business district. We rang the bell and the door was opened by Otto Frank. 6 feet tall, erect, with sparse silver hair. Mr. Frank had been an officer in the German army in the First War. And he and his wife, Fritzi, who we met in Auschwitz, served us coffee. His first wife, Edith, and his daughter, Anna, and Margot died in Bergen-Belsen. After a time, Mr. Frank went to a filing cabinet and removed something wrapped in cloth. He placed it on the table and unfolded the cloth, and before us was Anne's diary with the red checkered cover, the distinct handwriting, and the carefully pasted photos. Later, he took us to the Prinzenkracht, the spice factory on the where they hid. We climbed four flights to the hiding place concealed behind the false bookcase. And there, Otto Frank told us of the day the Green Police came to take them away. He described their leader, a Captain Silberbauer, who snatched his briefcase and shook everything onto the floor, then scooping up the money and the jewelry and leaving on the floor, amidst a pile of papers, that red checkered notebook as they herded their captives out. Captain Silverbauer left on that floor the evidence. My father was deeply moved that this young girl's voice had captured hearts across the world and endured while those strident voices of the Third Reich were silent. Now, I learned from my father at unexpected moments. One night in 1952, I went with him to the Academy Awards. It was the year of A Place in the Sun, his film with Elizabeth Taylor, Montgomery Clift, and Shelley Winters, based on Dreiser's An American Tragedy. I sat with him as he won his first Oscar. And on the way home, he was driving the car and the statue was on the seat between us. My mother and grandmother in the back seat. And I was excited. I was 17 years old, and I think perhaps he thought I was too excited, because I'll never forget, he looked over at me and smiled and said, "We'll have a better idea of what kind of a film this is in about 25 years. Well, it spoke to his values. For him, even on that glittery night, it was about the test of time, a concept that affected my life and my work, and it was his hallmark. My father made a decision, Ron referred to, Ronald, to go to war, leaving his career, his wife, and his 10-year-old son for what turned out to be 3 years. He was at 37, too old to be called to war, but he knew where he belonged. And thinking about that in the context of this occasion, I realized that that decision defined the kind of man he was, and the war experience defined the kind of filmmaker he would become. I have a V-mail letter he wrote to my mother in the winter of 1944 from the snows of the Ardennes Forest during the Battle of the Bulge, in which he describes his experience. He said, "It's like having a seat on the 50-yard line and seeing men at their best and at their worst." Yes, he witnessed the nobility of the human spirit, and he witnessed and filmed, as evidence, the unspeakable depravity of Dachau. His understanding of the human condition was deepened by what he saw, and the motion pictures he left for posterity were informed by his time at war. I know, were my father here today, he would consider himself a voice in the chorus of the World Jewish Congress. He, like you, was determined to preserve the memory of the Holocaust and of the millions who died, and he believed at his core in tolerance, human decency, and injustice. So I accept this award with what I know would be George Stevens' complete embrace of the noble and urgent purpose of the World Jewish Congress. Thank you so very much.